Brad Keithley, Managing Director of Alaskans for Sustainable Budgets. Welcome to the weekly top three, the top three things on our mind here at Alaskans for Sustainable Budgets for the week of March 25th, 2019. The weekly top three is a regular segment on the Michael Duke Show. The show broadcasts on Facebook Live and via streaming audio from the show's website, weekdays from 6 to 8 a.m. I join Michael on the show each Tuesday morning from 6:20 to 7 a.m. for a discussion between the two of us about our three issues. We post the podcast of our discussion following the show on the Alaska for Sustainable Budgets Facebook, YouTube, and SoundCloud pages, and on my website at bgkeithley.com. You can find past episodes of the weekly top three also at the same locations. Keep in mind that in addition to these podcasts, during the week, you also can follow and participate in the discussion with us of these and other issues affecting Alaska's fiscal and economic condition by following us on the Alaska for Sustainable Budgets Facebook page and through our posts on Twitter. This week, our top three issues are these. First, the false choice the Alaska House majority is pushing between spending cuts and PFD cuts. There are other options that are better for most Alaskans, which the House steadfastly is refusing to discuss. Second, Governor Mike Dunleavy's 10-year outlook. It's the most important analysis we have seen in the 7 years since the start of the state's fiscal crisis about the various alternative ways forward. To us, it's a very important read. Our third issue concerned whether the Buckeye Institute, identified in the 10-year plan, intends to provide the same type of distributional look at the impact of various options on Alaskans that the Institute for Taxation and Economic Policy did in 2017. But we ran out of time before reaching that issue on the show. We will return to it in subsequent episodes. And now, let's join Michael.
We're going to kick off with number one in what I thought was a mixed blessing. I mean, you know, when the House announced that they were going to be doing these road shows around the state of Alaska, I was happy and you know, I was kind of, it was a mixed emotions at the point, because I was happy because for the first time they were going to be holding the legislative sessions, portions of them anyway, for public testimony on the road system, and nobody in Juneau threw a fit, which I thought was shocking. And Alaskans got a chance to go out there and vote. Now, they can never hear again about how we've held session on the road and nobody showed up. Now, it didn't mean that everybody that I wanted to showed up, but it is what it is. But there were some other things that they were out there peddling as well that wasn't nearly as good. Let's talk about the House road shows and this dichotomy, this false narrative that they seem to want to peddle out there on the road.
I got to tell you, I was hugely disappointed at these roadshows and what the House Finance Committee did. The presentations they did and the slides they handed out were focused on one thing, and it was you're either for budget cuts or if you want to maintain spending, then we've got to cut the PFD. There wasn't any discussion of any other alternative other than cutting the PFD. It was binary. It's one or the other. We either cut the budget, we cut all these services that people want to, in various places, want to keep, or we cut the PFD. I mean, it actually, Michael, people are going to, you know, sort of chuckle at this, but it made me long for the days of Paul Seaton, when at least Paul Seaton would admit that there were other mechanisms to finance government. Now, Seaton never wanted to cut the budget in the way that Governor Dunleavy does, and the way you and I have talked about on this show for the past several years. But at least Seaton admitted that there were other ways to finance other ways to finance spending, more equitable ways, ways that were softer on the Alaska economy, better for the Alaska economy than cutting the PFD. But this roadshow had none of that. It was, you know, the three charts they had, the three slides they had, were all PFD cuts or budget cuts.
Right.
And that's just a false narrative. It's an absolutely false choice. You and I have talked a lot about flat taxes on the show, and flat taxes are a lot better for 80% of Alaska families than PFD cuts. PFD cuts are geared to help the top 20% avoid, dodge the cost of Alaska government. If we're going to keep Alaska spending high, PFD cuts are the mechanism to enable the top 20% of Alaskans to dodge paying a proportionate share of the cost of that high spending. They're geared, PFD cuts are geared to dump those costs, dump the costs of continued high spending onto the remaining 80%, particularly middle and lower income Alaska families. But there was none of that. I mean, right. No discussion of that in the roadshow whatsoever.
Well, and let's take the first slide just for an example. And for those of you who are listening on the radio, I'll be posting these on Facebook so you can go take a look at them. But the one that really got me was that first one. I mean, they're not even pretending. I mean, right at the top of the page, it says budget cuts versus PFD. And then it shows you the various levels, a $3,000 PFD, a $1,600 PFD, a $630 PFD. And they're like, here's your choices. Well, wait a second. None of those are the choices that I want to take. Pay the statutory PFD and bring government down within its means. That's not even an option for these guys. They're not even talking about that.
Yeah, exactly right. To follow up on that, in the James Brooks article that you were talking about, earlier in the show before I came on, there's a piece down in there that I think is very telling. And this is Andy Josephson, who's on the who's actually my representative from the district I live in, talking about, and who's a member of the House Finance Committee, talking about how the House Majority Caucus is dealing with this. It's set up with a quote from Colleen Sullivan Leonard that you repeated. It says, the million-dollar question is how we're going to pay for it, said Representative Colleen Sullivan Leonard, Republican Wasilla, and a member of the Finance Committee. A smaller permanent fund dividend is likely part of the answer. Josephson said he'd like to see lawmakers take a different approach and raise taxes, other taxes, thus allowing them to fund the dividend and services. But there isn't enough support in the 25-member coalition House majority to take that track. Unfortunately, the political winds reflected that there's just a binary solution, that dividends may be smaller than statutorily authorized. In other words, the House Majority Caucus have decided, and this is a caucus, this is a 25-member caucus, 17 members of which are either Democrats or 15 Democrats and two independents. So presumably people who go around saying, hey, we're standing here for middle and lower income Alaska families. This is a House Majority Caucus that's saying it's either PFD cuts or it's budget cuts. We're not going to consider anything else. And that's just a false choice. It's a false choice. It's budget. It's spending versus new revenues. If we're going to continue to spend, we do need revenues. But PFD cuts are not the only revenue choice. I really am curious, in this 25-member House caucus, I mean, I understand that Steve Thompson, who's a representative from the top 20%, Jennifer Johnson, who's a representative from the top 20%, Chuck Kopp, who's a representative from the top 20%, I understand they're going to favor PFD cuts. But in this 25-member caucus, I would be fascinated, extremely interested in a roll call of what 13 members, assuming they go by majority vote, what 13 members are pushing for PFD cuts instead of looking at other options. What 13 members are making this the false choice between spending cuts or PFD cuts?
And that's really the million-dollar question, because these guys are the ones that, you know, most of these people ran on. When they re-ran, most of them said, yep, we're going to give you the PFD, we're going to do this, we're going to do that. That was one of the top three issues, of course, budget, PFD, and crime, which we haven't done a whole lot with this year, which is surprising since it was the hot-button issue of the election. But here we go. This is the answer right here, is to just cut the PFD. I too would like to know who else is jumping on board. And we can see some of the usual candidates and culprits on this. But the fact that they are so blatant about it, just budget cuts versus the PFD. And we could see that's how they were going to frame the argument from the very beginning. I've been warning people that this is what's coming, that they're not even going to really give you a choice on this. But it's really shocking to see it in stark contrast like this in black and white.
Yeah, is it? I mean, so we know who the 25 members are, and you can start going down. You can start going down the list. If you assume that Democrats who say that they're concerned about impacts on middle and lower income Alaska families, and they're concerned about the overall impact on the Alaska economy, PFD cuts have the largest adverse impact of all the choices on the overall Alaska economy. If you assume that there's some core Democrats who like Josephson say that they would prefer another option rather than just PFD cuts, who in that 25 member caucus is pushing for PFD cuts? Who's holding? Is Tammy Wilson one of those who's now pushing for PFD cuts? Has she gone over? And is she one of those who's now supporting PFD cuts as opposed to other options? We're going to need to work down this list, or I'm going to be working down this list, ferret out statements they've made, and try to identify who is really at the core of trying to protect the top 20% at the expense of middle and lower income Alaska families.
Well, and just quick sidebar, I'm getting a little concerned. I mean, here again, I just mentioned that crime was the number one issue, and we need to basically punish the criminals and incarcerate criminals, and instead, Tammy Wilson is pushing forward a proposal that instead of putting these guys in jail would increase now the monitoring and the ankle bracelet and all this other kind of stuff. I mean, I don't know what her constituents are thinking, but when I read that, I had to reread that portion of the article several times to get my head around it. Like, wait, this is the same, this is the same issue that the vast majority of Alaskans are very frustrated with. They were basically giving them the revolving door and the keys to the kingdom by allowing them out. And now, instead of shipping them off to a cheaper solution outside, we're going to try and create even more ways that they could stay out of prison and be free on the people's dime, so to speak. So, I mean, I don't even know what to say at this point. I'm just shocked.
Yeah, it's very frustrating. I mean, it's very frustrating that we have a situation in which we have representatives essentially closing their eyes to better alternatives. I mean, even if you assume that we're going to keep spending levels high, closing their eyes to better alternatives for 80% of Alaska families, 80% of Alaska families, and the overall Alaska economy. Closing their eyes to options that are better for 80% of Alaska families and the overall economy, and continuing to go down this track of protecting the top 20%.
Well, and what really shocks me is that they're not even talking about the effect of PFD cuts. That's the thing. I mean, they keep talking about the overall budget, the economy, the government, but none of them have taken a hard look and really talked about what the effect would be and what the effect is of a taking of the PFD on Alaskans as a whole. And you've got a second chart in that post that you put up that talks about the comparison of effects on Alaska's family of the PFD cuts. And you use it for during the flat tax. But what gets me is that you can look at it and you could see the effect this disparity of the top 20% versus the lowest 20% and everywhere in between. We're talking about taking the percentage of income from people ranging from, 1.6% on the top end to 20% on the bottom end. That's insane.
Yeah, and that's at a $1,600 PFD. I mean, when you look at what the House Finance is doing and the miserably low level of cuts that they've made thus far in the subcommittee process, you're looking at something that's much lower than a $1,600 PFD. You're looking at something that's in the range of a $600 PFD. And there, the impact on middle and lower income Alaska families of that sort of PFD cut is 11% for just a middle income Alaska family. We're taking more than 10% of a middle income Alaska family's income by PFD cuts, and you get up to 35% in the lowest 20% of Alaska families. It's shocking the effect that this has, the tilted effect of PFD cuts against middle and lower income Alaska families. And as ICER, as the 2016 ICER analysis demonstrates, or the 2016 ICER analysis demonstrates, the effect, the knock-on effect that has on the overall Alaska economy. It's shocking how tilted that is, how protective of the top 20% at the expense of the rest of Alaskans and the, at the expense of the rest of the Alaska economy. It's shocking how tilted that is. But that's the only option that that House Finance and the Majority House Caucus says they can talk about. I mean, they have members. Obviously, Josephson is talking about something different. Ivy Sponholz has talked about something different. So they have members who recognize the tilted effect and who want to talk about different options that are better for Alaska families and better for the overall Alaska economy. But somehow inside that caucus, it's being cut off, that those who want to protect the top 20% are stifling that debate. And we need to find out who inside that caucus is siding with the top 20% against the remaining 80% of Alaska families, who's siding with the top 20% against the overall Alaska economy.
Well, and that's because that's what it's really become. It's really become class warfare. I mean, income-based. Like, if you're in the top 20%, we're here to protect you from getting hit too hard. Everybody else can go suck it, essentially, is what it is. No matter what the effect is on people, and again, we're looking at this down the lowest 20% where they're being affected by, you know, 34% of their income being taken by government versus, you know, 2 or 1% on the top 20 or the top 10 or the top 5. You know, that is a direct attack on the rest of Alaskans outside of that top 20%. And I agree. I think we need to call names and figure out who's in favor of this and who's not. Class warfare and generational warfare is what Kathleen says, Brad, and I can't disagree with her. I mean, that's exactly what we're facing. This is generational warfare. Those who are in the catbird seat right now, kicking the can down the road to our children and grandchildren, and protecting those upper income earners in the state of Alaska, basically leaving everybody else to rot or pay for it.
Yeah, exactly right. I mean, Andy Josephson sort of had in the piece in the James Brooks article has sort of pulled back the curtain a little bit. And he said, yes, there are some of us in this caucus, because this is the caucus that's making the decision. There are some of us in this caucus who want to use other mechanisms. If we're going to spend this money, who want to use other mechanisms in order to make this a much fairer distribution of impact of raising the revenues to spend the money. There are some of us in this caucus who want to do that. But the majority of the caucus has decided that we're going to go down this track that protects the top 20%. Well, okay, let's pull the curtain all the way back. Let's go through all 25 members in that caucus. And let's start talking about, are they for, are they protecting the top 20%, or are they in favor of the bulk of Alaskans, the remaining 80%, the middle and lower income Alaska families? And, you know, you can put some people immediately over on the top 20%. You can say Steve Thompson from Fairbanks has been very clear throughout. He wants to cut the PFD, and he's prepared to cut the PFD down to zero if that's what it takes in order to protect the top 20%. And Chuck Kopp has made many of the same statements. And Jennifer Johnston has made many of the same statements over time. So you can start counting down. You can start counting down. There are others who have said that they're there to protect the bulk of Alaska families, middle and lower income Alaska families, the overall Alaska economy, and you can put those. And I'm guessing over time I'm going to be able to piece together enough statements to figure out what's going on in there. And I'm guessing when I do, there are going to be people who are saying one thing and doing another. Behind the closed doors of the caucus.
Wait, really? I mean, that would never. I mean, politicians, they would never do that. Never do that. I mean, it's, you know, and here's what gets me is that they are completely ignoring the will of the people. Now, do they do that at their own peril, or are they counting on the fact that people are very short term? They don't remember. They don't keep track of it. I mean, what are your thoughts?
Oh yeah. Well, I mean. Yeah, I think they're counting on the fact that people won't remember, and I think they're counting on the fact that the curtain can remain pulled, and that they can say one thing out in public and do another thing in private, and blame it off on, you know, oh, I wanted to to, like Andy Josephson, I wanted to, you know, do it more fairly, but oh, it was the other people in the, in that room that, you know, that made us do it, made it do us this way. This goes back to another problem you and I have talked about before, which is the binding caucus. I mean, we've now got a situation in which we know that there are people inside that caucus that want to do things more fairly. If we're going to have to raise money, if we're going to keep spending at high enough levels that we have to raise money, that want to do it more fairly, we know there are people in there that want to do it, but they're being bound to vote for what the caucus as a whole decides, which is to protect the top 20% at the expense of the remaining 80%. And so we're going right back into the same binding caucus issue that we've had problems with before,
which again is one of our charter of changes that we've said needs to happen, because this stuff just can't go on. I mean, it just can't, because they can hide behind it, as we just said, they can hide behind it and then say, well, I tried, but, you know, I was bound by the caucus, and if I wanted to get anything done, then I had to toe the line and yada, yada, yada. I made all my cuts in subcommittee, as Tammy would tell me. I attempted to do all my things. I had to play ball once I got out on the floor, which I think in a lot of ways is an easy way to, dodge the bullet in the end. You could do those things, especially tilt at windmills when you know you're not going to make it. And then when it comes, push comes to shove, you can vote, with the majority and still have that political cover.
Yeah, well, they didn't even make the cut subcommittee. I mean,
well, this time around they didn't. Yeah, no.
A $1.6 billion deficit, and the subcommittees made $38 billion in aggregate cuts. That's a joke. That's a joke. They're not even trying. And if I go into those $38 million, I bet a not insignificant part of even that $38 million is budget gimmicks, as opposed to real live cuts.
Oh my God, we didn't even get into the voodoo sorcery of the shell games. That's true. I hadn't even looked at that. Now we'll have to take a look. But we're moving on to number two, which is finally we've got the governor's 10-year plan. And it's anybody that wants to read it can see the truth on the wall. Brad, what are your thoughts on the governor's 10-year plan?
This is the most important document that has been published in the last 7 years in the state of Alaska on fiscal issues. This is a document we should have had in 2015 when we started into this fiscal dive that we've had the last 7 years. It's a document we should have had at the beginning, frankly, of Governor Dunleavy's term. It was due under the statute on December 15th as part of the original budget. I can understand why it might have been delayed some from that, but it's been delayed 3 months. And I think it would have made a difference had this document been available sooner in the session rather than later. But we've got it now. And this is, if there are people listening who haven't read this document, and you want to know about the state of Alaska's fiscal situation, this is the document you've got to read. It is everything that I would ever want discussed about Alaska's fiscal situation in one document. It does a great job of laying out four scenarios that talks about, you know, where we're going to go. The first is Governor Dunleavy's budget, or where we could go. The first is Governor Dunleavy's budget, which is spending cuts, significant spending cuts, and preserving the PFD as is under the current statute going forward, and how that plays out over the next 10 years. And then the second scenario is continuing to balance the budget by reducing PFDs. It's on page 11 of the document. If you have not looked at that chart, the scenario two chart on page 11 of the document, you absolutely have to do that. It shows that continuing to balance the budget by reducing PFDs, which, you know, if you look at what the House Finance Committee was saying over the weekend, is the direction they're going. The PFD, and hold on to your hats, and I know the people who listened to the show yesterday already know this, but the PFD disappears in two more years. Disappears. Not just is cut, is gone in two more years. Scenario three talks about avoiding fixing the problem by making unsustainable draws. That's what we've been doing the last 7 years. We've been writing down $16 billion in savings over the last 7 years. Scenario three is, what if we continue to do that and we start writing down the earnings reserve account, using that now as a reserve category, as a savings category, and start writing it down. It shows that and continue spending the way we have. It shows that the earnings reserve account, which funds not only the PFD, but also funds the portion of earnings that are going to support government, that the earnings reserve account is gone by 2028, is drained out by 2027. And in 2028, we don't even have the earnings reserve account left. And then the final scenario is balancing the budget with new taxes, with alternative fundraising mechanisms in the PFD. Now, this one I take issue with because of the way in which they're calculating the per person taxes. They're calculating it in a way to sort of hype the number more than I think is fair. But nonetheless, it's a representation of what it takes. We're going to continue with a status quo budget, and we're going to finance it with new taxes. And these four scenarios are the way that we should have been thinking about this issue since the beginning, since 2015. It's the way we should be thinking about the issue now. And the document does just an absolutely outstanding job in putting together the picture. Now, understanding that it does such an outstanding job, the Democrats immediately started complaining about it. Bryce Edgman on Friday afternoon told Andrew Kitchman of Alaska Public Radio, Alaska Public News, that it was too late. It wasn't helpful because, you know, the governor should be working with the House now. He shouldn't be, you know, putting out these documents that defend his position, and that it was flawed because it didn't show a middle road. It didn't show, you know, something like some spending cuts with some new revenue options. It didn't do that. Well, you can figure all that out. I mean, it's like a rocket scientist, right, to figure out the middle points in this. But this is an absolutely critical document. The governor's office has done a terrific job. Department of Revenue, OMB have done a terrific job putting this document together. It ought to be the document that everybody carries around and uses as a template on how we're going to deal with this issue from here on out.
Well, and it's amazing, again, Bryce Edgman and the kind of commentary that we see of, well, you've got to, you know, he should have met us in the middle. And, you know, you can reach into the middle, too. You know, you could come up with some solutions other than status quo, which seems to be the solution that they want to push on right now. Just status quo. Not even holding government to the same level with the automatic escalators and the increases. They just want to, you know, we're just going to keep it going the way it is. That seems to be the answer.
Yeah, it was really humorous to read. I mean, it took me a while to get around to reading the Kitchman article that had Bryce's quote on it. And by the time I did, shortly after, I was reading the article that talked about the $38 million in cuts that they made. So, yeah, I'm not sure where Bryce is getting, you know, we're going to make these big cuts and this document doesn't take this into account. $38 million in cuts is not big cuts. But this is just an excellent article. And frankly, if I were controlling things in a way that nobody can, but if I were to try to put it up, I would have people in the legislature say, all right, are you for scenario one, scenario two, scenario three, or scenario four? Because that's basically what we've come down to. They're really, these capture all of the options that are out there, and you know, people are making decisions. The House Majority Caucus is now saying that they're for scenario two, continue to balance the budget by reducing PFDs. And that's the scenario. Again, folks, if you haven't looked at this document The links to it are on, I'm sure, are on the show's website. They're on the Alaskans for Sustainable Budgets Facebook page. If you haven't read this document, looked at this document, just in all you need to do is pick it up and look at page 11. You see that the scenario and the track that the House says they're on now is scenario two, and that eliminates PFDs in 2 years.
That kicks the can down a very short road, because now you've only got 2 years, and then you're out of money there. Then what do you do? And see, that's the problem. Then what do you do? And nobody seems to be thinking about this in the long term. It's always this year, this year, this year. We'll take the PFDs. Now, Charlie makes a good point in the chat room. He says one of the things that he thinks that it's not necessarily class warfare. The PFD is the only readily available pot of money. Any taxing system won't produce money for some time. We need to make the cuts to put them in place for longer term fixes, which I agree with. Brad, we're down to less than a minute. I'm sorry. I just looked at the clock. So give me your thoughts and we'll wrap up.
Well, I think that's wrong. There are ways that we can do interim financing until we get a tax system up. We can do withholding off the PFD, for example, to provide interim financing till we can get the tax system up. A flat tax is not a very complicated system. It's just a percent of AGI. Easy to implement, easy to do. So I think that's just wrong.
All right. Final thoughts here as we wrap up. 25 seconds.
Well, if nobody has read this, if there's anybody out there who hasn't read this document, read it. And now start to think about scenario one, scenario two, scenario three, and scenario four, and put people in these categories. The House majority is in scenario two. They are going to eliminate the PFD on the road they're going down.
I mean, when you read these scenarios, you could just see that. I mean, that somebody read this and all the color drained out of their face when they kind of laid it out in stark terms of, wow, this is really what we're facing right now. This is exactly what we're facing, and I guess we're just going to continue blindly ahead.
Yeah, this is a document. This is a document I wish we'd done in 2015, 2016, 17, 18. Now we're doing it late in 2019, but now we're finally doing it, and it's a document that really lays out the four paths that Alaska has in front of it. And you really can see. I mean, you can step back and say, okay, the House says that they're not going to make big cuts. That's the effect of the subcommittee action. The House says they're going to take it out of the hide of the PFD. That's what Andy Josephson said in today's paper. Okay, let me go to the document. Yep, that's scenario two. And yep, the PFD's gone in 2 years. So let's say Bryce says, oh, we're going to make some more cuts. Well, maybe we can get the PFD out to 3 years. But the PFD, the way the House majority is going, the PFD goes away.
Yep.
We eliminate a mechanism that has a hugely positive effect on the overall Alaska economy, has a hugely positive effect on 80% of Alaska families, just so we can protect the top 20%. It's going away. That's where the House majority is taking us.
Very frustrating. Several people have commented in the chat room that they went out to the governor's meeting in the Kenai last night, and they said Beeble said it was enlightening. I feel like I can think clearer now after seeing and hearing the budget details and the directions or choices we have. Unfortunately, I think there's a large public sector that's being misinformed, or should I say indoctrinated. It's scary to see this. And I got to tell you, Cindy says, regardless of the personal feelings of last night's meeting, the presentation was very sombering and everyone should be talking. It was about as factual as it gets. Alaskans need to watch his videos, go to their meetings, get a hold of the presentation and hold our government accountable, which I agree. And unfortunately, the special interest has grabbed the wheel of the bus and is driving this thing right now and telling us, you know, again, giving us this false dichotomy of your PFD versus budget cuts.
Yeah, what the governor's doing in these meetings is going through the four scenarios. What the House did in their meetings, I mean, the House had a perfect opportunity to get out there and inform Alaskans, to give Alaskans choices. What the House chose was just say, it's our way or the highway, it's scenario two. We're going down scenario two, by the way. It's just how deep do you want us to go down scenario two? How much do you want us to continue spending? We're going to take it out of the PFD. That's our choice. And the governor's just doing a much better service to Alaskans. I know he gets beaten up in the press, but the governor's doing a much better service to Alaskans by going out and talking about these four scenarios and saying, which of these do you want to do, as opposed to the House that's prejudged which scenario, which road they're going down, and making the decision for Alaskans, even though not everybody in the caucus agrees with it. We don't know which ones yet, but making the decision for Alaskans that we're going down scenario two.
Well, it has been frustrating, too, the way that they've handled this kind of a political disaster with the AFP thing and the registering to go to the governor's plan and everything else. I mean, he should have rented the largest auditorium he could find and just brought everybody in and sat down and educated everybody. Even the people that disagree with him, even the rabble rousers, they should have had an opportunity to come in there and hear what he has to say. I think that's been a major misstep here by his administration. But like you said, getting this information out there is going to be eye-opening for everybody.
It is. I mean, does the House tell you that they're eliminating the PFD? No. They talk about PFD cuts. But you look, I mean, that's the beauty of 10-year plans. You look at how these policies play out over time. Scenario two makes very clear that the road the House is taking us down eliminates the PFD. It's not a PFD cut. It's a PFD elimination. To protect the top 20%. And that's the beauty of these 10-year plans. And if I could put one of these in every Alaskan's hands, I would do it.
Well, we're gonna do it. We're going to post it up on our Facebook page. At the top of the page, though, we will post the governor's 10-year plan. I have a copy of it. And so we will drop it there on the top of the Facebook page, and people can go watch it and take a look at it and read it. It's a 20-page document. It's not a light read, but it has so much information. And when you look down at the various opportunities, you realize there's really only a couple options here, and then we're done.
Yep. Yep. Yeah, and as I say, that's the 10-year plan. I mean, ICE is trying to lay this off that we're only doing this, you know, we're going to take 50 cuts this year. We're going to ramp down spending a little bit, $38 million. We're going to ramp down spending a little bit. We're going to take it. We're going to fund it with PFDs, and then just keep working on this. Well, that's scenario two tells you where Bryce's approach takes us.
Yeah.
And the PFD's gone.
And I guess maybe you want to put on your psychologist hat for just a minute, Brad, and tell me why are we doing this? I mean, why is this, you know, why are they taking us down this road? I guess is my main question. What's the point if they know that it's the destruction of everything that, you know, that we need? What's the point?
Well, we talked about it last week, Michael. It's two things. They're protecting two things. They're protecting government spending. And the constituencies we've built up around government spending, including the education constituency, university constituency, healthcare constituency, we're protecting constituencies, and to be very blunt, we're protecting the top 20%. We're not going to have the top 20% contribute significantly to solving this problem. We're going to take it out of the hides of the remaining 80%, even though it has the largest adverse impact on the overall Alaska economy. We're going to take it out of the hides because we are going to protect the top 20%. That's it.
All right.
They're protecting two groups.
We're out of time. Brad Keithley, Alaskans for Sustainable Budgets. Thank you so much for coming on board and joining us today. We really appreciate it.
Michael, as always, thanks for having me. Well, that's a wrap for another week's edition of the weekly top three from Alaskans for Sustainable Budgets. Thank you again for joining us. Remember that you can find past episodes on our YouTube and SoundCloud pages, and keep track of us during the week on Facebook and Twitter. This has been Brad Keithley, Managing Director of Alaskans for Sustainable Budgets. We look forward to you joining us again next week on the Weekly Top 3.